So let's get Sarah up here if she wants to say a few words, but thank you all for coming out. This is going to be a great event. It's already started out great. And like I like to call this, this is the silent revolution that we're all involved in here. Thank you.
Thing on? All right, it is. Hey everybody, welcome. Thank you so much for coming out. Okay, so I'll tell you a little bit about the Southern Alliance for Clean Energy. First of all, my name is Sarah Gillum and I am the communications coordinator. I get to work here in lovely Asheville on digital communications and social media and web and blog for the Southern Alliance for Clean Energy. And we are a regional nonprofit that works all throughout the Southeast on advancing climate initiatives and working with lovely folks in the community on electric vehicles and solar and wind power, and then also fighting the dirty stuff, the coal and the nuclear, because they are not climate solutions. So that's a little bit about SACE. We have a table here today. We're one of the co-partners for the event. And please come talk to us. Don't be strangers. We have an office here in Asheville. We also have a solar-powered electric vehicle charger, a level 2 charger, at our office downtown. It is open to the public, and you can come and ride on sunshine, which, like today, is a pretty cool and a pretty empowering thing to be able to totally unplug from fossil fuels. So without further ado, I am so excited to introduce our special guest today, race car driver and carbon-free girl, Leilani Munter. So let's make her full welcome, guys. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to National Drive Electric Week. This is so incredible to see so many different kinds of electric cars out here. You know, a few years ago, there would have been like Leafs and Roadsters, and now there's so many different kinds of electric cars and hybrids out here. I don't even know all of them, which is amazing. So welcome to the electric car revolution. If you're here, I assume that you are either an electric car owner already or you are thinking about becoming one. I know whenever they bill me for speaking at these events, they always say race car driver, and that's true. I do drive race cars, but I really consider myself more of an activist than a driver. The race car is just a way for me to sort of get these messages out about these important issues that we need to talk about. And by being here to support this electric car revolution, you are becoming a part of the solution. I had a moment in 2010 in the spring when the Deepwater Horizon oil rig sank to the bottom of the Gulf of Mexico. About 10 days after the oil rig sank, I went down to Louisiana and I went in a little boat out to try and document what was going on with the oil spill. It was very early on. It was before the oil had actually even hit the shore. And it was before they had sort of, the Coast Guard had sort of cut people off from going into the ocean. And we were out there looking for the oil, trying to find it. I was out there with the National Wildlife Federation. And we were about 75 miles away from where the Deepwater Horizon sank. And we hadn't seen anything yet. And then all of a sudden we hit the oil. And there was a moment where I looked up and from horizon to horizon, all I could see was crude oil. And it was a moment that just honestly knocked the wind out of me. I could not believe what I was seeing. And I made a decision in my head at that moment that I would never again own a gasoline-powered vehicle. This was something I didn't want to participate in. Thank you. When we live on this planet, there's 7.4 billion people on the planet right now. There's a growth rate of about 300,000 people per day. Our day-to-day choices make a really big difference on our impact on the planet. And so by driving an electric car, you are choosing to be a part of the solution rather than a part of the problem. I've spent the last about 4 years of my life working on a documentary film called Racing Extinction. Has anybody here seen Racing Extinction? Awesome, a few of you have. So for those of you who have not, Racing Extinction is a documentary film that aired on the Discovery Channel in December. You can get it on all the on-demand, like Google and Amazon and iTunes now. It was made by the Oceanic Preservation Society, the same people who made the Academy Award winning documentary, The Cove. The Cove is actually the most winning documentary of all time, won 70 awards globally, including the Academy Award. And ever since The Cove won the Academy Award in 2010, the Oceanic Preservation Society has been filming Racing Extinction. And in it, I don't want to give too much away, but in it I drive a very, very cool one-of-a-kind Tesla Model S. That's sort of like a James Bond version of a Tesla Model S. And that movie is about the 6 mass extinction of species that we're currently living through right now. So right now, scientists estimate that we're actually losing species at a rate 1,000 times greater than the natural background rate of extinction. They call this era the Anthropocene, which translates to the age of man. It's where the human impact on our planet is so great that we are actually changing the fossil record of the future. I believe that these issues with climate change and the loss of biodiversity, these are the most important issues that human beings have ever faced. And we all need to work together to change the way that we're living on our planet. Charles Darwin once said, "It is not the strongest of the species that survives, nor is it the most intelligent. It is the one that is most adaptable to change." And so it is time for us to utilize our intelligence to adapt and to change the way that we're living and driving on this planet. And by owning and driving and being enthusiasts for electric cars, we are becoming a part of that solution of adapting and changing and making the world a better place. And every time any one of us that has an electric car is out there driving, regardless of what kind of electric car you're driving, you are planting a seed. Because every single person that sees you out there driving that electric car is gonna have a little seed planted in their head thinking, huh, maybe I'll make my next car electric. I've now done over 41,000 miles on my Tesla Model S since I bought it in September of 2013. I've got solar panels on the roof of my house. So when I'm charging at home, I'm charging on free solar, which I don't think it really gets any better than driving on sunshine, right? It doesn't get any cleaner than that. It's an incredibly freeing feeling to never have to stop at gas stations. I mean, the only time I go to gas stations now is if I need to buy a lottery ticket or I want to flip it off, which occasionally I might do if you follow me on social media. This is such an important part of changing the future, and I do believe that in 10 to 20 years, all the cars on the road are going to be electric. And when somebody goes by in an internal combustion engine, the rest of us are going to look at the car and kind of be like, wow, I didn't realize people still drove those old antiques. So weird. You know, we will see internal combustion engines, but it will be in car museums. They are a part of the past, and we are a part of the future. And that is so important. So the fact that you guys are all here today, I just want to say thank you, because that means that you are either already a part of the solution or you want to become a part of the solution. And this is how we're really going to change the world. I can't stress how important it is and how much of an honor I feel in being able to be somebody who gets to drive an electric car. We're the minority right now. But eventually we are going to be the majority. And the reason that I believe this is that there's actually a group of scientists that wanted to figure out if there was a tipping point for ideas a few years ago. And so they did a study on the spread of ideas. And what these scientists found was that if just 10% of the population had an unwavering belief in an idea, it is inevitable that the rest of the society adopt that idea. So with every single new owner of an electric car, we are getting closer and closer to that 10% tipping point. And I do believe that we will get there. I really want to thank you guys for being here and for being a part of the solution. Please check out Racing Extinction if you get a chance. I know there's some teachers here. I've already talked to a few people that are science teachers. If you are a science teacher, thank you for doing what you're doing to educate the next generation. there is actually a downloadable version of lesson plans on racing extinction. So if you screen the film in your classroom, you don't have to make the lesson plan. You can just go onto racingextinction.com and go to the education level, and you can download all different kind of grade levels of lesson plans. It's so important that we obviously educate the next generation of people that are going to eventually be running this planet. But I know that I have so much hope. I mean, I feel like, you know, people are creatures of habit, and sometimes it's hard for us to change our ways. And we're stuck in our old ways. Well, we're used to going to gas stations or whatever, and people feel insecure about whether or not they can do road trips. And this is really nothing you have to worry about. I've done 41,000 miles, like I said, in my own personal Tesla. I've done another 10 to 15,000 in the Racing Extinction Tesla, including a 5,000 mile road trip from New York to San Francisco, where I was zigzagging across the country. And I never, not once, did I have to worry about finding some place to charge my car. That whole range anxiety myth is truly a myth. you never have to worry about it. And that's one of the first questions I always get asked when people find out I have an electric car. Oh, have you ever run out of, you know, charge and been stranded on the side of the road? And I'm always kind of like, no, do you like frequently run out of gas and find yourself sitting on the side of the freeway? Because, you know, you have a gauge to see how much charge you have left, and you know when to stop. So that whole range anxiety is really not a problem if you're not an electric car owner yet and you're worried about that. And one other thing that I will add as far as the racing goes, there are new electric car series, racing series coming up. There's already been the Formula E series, which is an electric open wheel series that runs all over the world. And there's a new series actually starting up in Barcelona next year that's using all Tesla Model S's, highly modified versions of Tesla Model S's, but that's the base model. So pretty soon, hopefully, I won't just be driving an electric car in my personal life, but hopefully on the racetrack as well. And I think that will be a real sign that, you know, electric cars have arrived, and even racing is going to start shifting over into using electric cars instead of burning any sort of fossil fuels. So thank you for being here. Thank you for being part of the solution, and just keep going out there and pushing this message, because it is so important that we make the right choices for the future of our planet. If we don't do that, then we're not going to be here. Climate change is here. Climate change is real. We cannot keep burning fossil fuels and putting millions and millions of tons of greenhouse gas emissions into the atmosphere. And I'm just gonna get on my vegan soapbox for one moment, because vegans can't help it. More greenhouse gas emissions actually go into raising animals for food than the entire transportation sector combined. Every single car, truck, ship, train, all added together, does not add up to the amount of greenhouse gas emissions that come from raising animals for food. And I know over there on that solar stove, they're cooking some vegan sausages. So this is another big part of the solution that we talk about in Racing Extinction. Making the way that you get around cleaner, so using an electric car, putting solar panels up on your roof if you can, and leaving meat and dairy off of your plate as much as you can. It makes a huge difference, especially with, like I said, think about the number, 7.4 billion people with a growth rate of 300,000 a day. That's not sustainable. It's just, the math does not work out. So we all need to be a part of reducing our carbon footprint and getting everyone around us to think about that. Not only in the car you drive, I know people automatically associate their carbon footprint with the kind of fuel that they burn and what kind of car they drive. And I am proud to drive an electric car and to have solar on my roof. But I also know that probably a bigger part of the solution, a bigger part of reducing my carbon footprint, is actually not eating meat or dairy products. So had to throw that out there because I can't help it. I'll get off my soapbox now. Thank you, everybody. Go electric cars. Is anybody else speaking? Thank you. Oh, thank you. Do you want to close your?
the Blue Ridge EV Club, we want to thank you so much for coming out today and speaking. We have some flowers for you, and also Janaki, my daughter, has baked you some cookies, vegan cookies. This is another gift from the Blue Ridge EV Club. Thank you so much.
I made them yesterday, they taste good.
Oh, awesome.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So racing is, you know, it's one of the most popular sports in the world. There are something like 75 million race fans in the United States. So I've been using my car. My degree is in biology. So I went to college at the University of California in San Diego, and my degree is in biology, specializing in ecology, behavior, and evolution. So it's sort of in the environmental world first, and then I'm a little bit of an adrenaline junkie. I like to jump out of airplanes and drive race cars and things like that. And so one of the things on my bucket list was to go drive a race car, and then I sort of stumbled into this racing world, and I quickly realized that, you know, this being a driver was sort of giving me access to this large demographic of people that I wouldn't have normally reached as an environmentalist or as a biologist. And I remember this one moment in 2006. So I started, 2006 was when An Inconvenient Truth came out, and I think that film was really That was a very like big turning point for climate change, because I think it was like the first time the vast majority of the population was even hearing about global warming and climate change. And that was when I started to use my racing website to talk about environmental issues. And I was promoting An Inconvenient Truth as a movie I wanted people to see. And I stumbled across a discussion that was happening on a NASCAR forum. So it's strictly a racing forum where people discussed like what was going on in NASCAR. And somebody started the thread basically throwing me under the bus and saying, you know, this driver is brainwashed by Al Gore and she's pushing this, you know, crazy global warming propaganda, and, you know, calling me all kinds of names. And by the time I found it, the thread was really long, because the only reason I found the thread was because I was getting so much traffic to my website from the forum. I was wondering why, so I went out of curiosity. And a lot of other people were chiming in to agree and sort of calling me names and throwing me under the bus, which is something that took a lot of getting used to. But as a female driver, you get used to pretty quickly people not being welcoming to you in that field, just because there's so few women. But then one person on the discussion thread said, have you actually seen An Inconvenient Truth? Because it's really sort of weird if you're trashing this driver and you're so angry with her about promoting An Inconvenient Truth and you haven't actually watched it. And so then the discussion shifted from not being about me, but then about the film and what the film was talking about, and about climate change. And by the end of the thread, there were actually people posting graphs of the parts per million of carbon dioxide in our atmosphere on a NASCAR forum. And I, you know, that helped me sort of, I got past all the personal attacks on myself and the name calling, and I got a big smile on my face, and I just remember feeling like, wow, I just got people to talk about the parts per million of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere on a NASCAR forum. And that really made me smile, and it made me realize that I could be a bridge, you know, between the environmentalists and the race fans, and I could get them talking about things that maybe they didn't normally talk about. And so my race car is always carrying messages about things that I think are solutions, like electric cars and solar and wind power, renewable energy. You know, I'm an animal rights activist, so a lot of documentaries like The Cove and Blackfish have been on my car. So my race cars are really more about cause related and shifts in our behavior, rather than like trying to sell somebody a candy bar or, you know, a soda or whatever. My cars don't carry those kinds of messages, and that's really powerful, that, you know, to be able to reach that big audience. At the same time, it would make me very happy if my race car was electric. Because then I would also be able to live how I live outside of the race car, but on the racetrack. the only issue there is there is like you don't know how big of an audience you're gonna have. So it's a much harder sell for me, right? When I'm trying to go to a company, I have no demographics to show them. Whereas with NASCAR and with ARCA, I can show them, okay, last year at Daytona, 3 million people were watching the race, and it's much easier to sort of sell the company on being a part of it. So that's a little bit of a struggle, but it's gonna take some time to get off its feet. But I do believe that racing is gonna go electric. There's more and more race car drivers every day that are starting to drive electric cars. There's quite a few that have Teslas. And when you've got a car that can be 0 to 60 in 2.5 seconds and is a 4,600 pound sedan that seats 7 people, it's pretty hard to argue with that. So I think the performance of the car is really important, and that's sort of what is helping it get into that realm of like racing. That being said, all of these cars are so important. You know, it's not about one electric car. I know, like, personally for me, that's what I drive, but all of these cars are a part of the solution, and it's so cool to me to see so many different kinds of electric cars that I actually didn't even know what some of them were pulling up, and I was like, what kind is that? I haven't seen that one before. And that is so important, and I think, you know, one of the reasons that I have a lot of, like, loyalty towards Tesla is because I think that they really push the envelope and force the hand of a lot of the other companies to get on board. Because once Tesla started taking away the sales of like Mercedes and BMW and Audi, they were starting to lose customers to electric cars, to a luxury electric car brand. And that's what made the other luxury electric car brands go, huh. Wait a minute, we're starting to lose customers. This is actually affecting our bottom line now. And as much as I like to believe people are good and companies are good and they're gonna do the right thing to do the right thing, at the end of the day, if they're losing money, they're gonna start making electric cars so that they can keep making money. So that's why I have a lot of enthusiasm for that particular company. But I love seeing all of these electric cars, and I can't wait until they're all electric. And I really do believe that time will come. I feel like there's more and more momentum. I don't know, how big was this event last year? Did you guys have as many electric cars here last year, or was it like half?
Yeah, half.
So less than half of the electric cars that are here today were here last year at the same event. So let's make it double. Next year, let's have twice as many as we have here today. And each year we're gonna keep growing like that. And that is what really gives me hope for the future of our planet. Because if we keep living the way that we're living on the planet now, then it's over. It's truly game over, and we're not gonna be here. We are acidifying our oceans. We are driving so many millions of species into extinction. I mean, this is not sustainable, you guys. And the solutions that I like to push, there's three main ones: solar, electric cars, and plant-based diet. I'm gonna add one more to it, and that's population. My husband and I are child-free by choice. When I was in college, I had a biochemistry professor that one day I came into class and sat down, and he said, "Everybody close your books. We're not talking about biochemistry today. I'm gonna show you a film." And he talked about it was a film about human population. And I walked all the way across the UCSD campus, which is a big campus, with my professor that day. And we talked about population. And I decided that day that, you know, I was not gonna participate in propagating the problem of human overpopulation. So this is something that, like, not a lot of people are talking about. I do feel like it's the big environmental, like, elephant in the room that nobody wants to talk about, because it is sort of an uncomfortable and controversial thing to talk about, but we have to talk about it. This is absolutely unsustainable. And one of the things that I spoke about, I was just in Aspen at a clean energy conference and talked about population. And I said, you know, if you really have that like need to be a parent, there's 132 million orphans in the world that don't have a home, that need a home. And after I got off the stage, I had a girl come running up to me and give me a big hug. She's maybe like 20. And she said, "Thank you so much for talking about the orphans. I'm adopted. And if my mom had had her own children, then she never would have found me. And it's such an important discussion that nobody ever talks about." And so I'm going to add a fourth solution to our problems that we're facing, and that is that this is an issue we just need to start talking about. We need to make it normal. It shouldn't be weird for me to say I'm child free by choice. It should be, you know, I should be able to say that and not have people go, oh, you know, and shift uncomfortably in their seats. We have to start talking about this. It is an unavoidable problem. We can't just keep sticking our heads in the sand and pretending that we don't know, you know, that we're adding 300,000 people to the planet every day, and this is just not, the math does not work. So yeah, I had to throw that out there because I think it's really important that we start normalizing talking about population. People get so weird about it, but I think just by speaking about it, it makes it feel more normal, right? I had a lot of people come up to me after I talked about it in Aspen and just said, thanks for bringing it up. Just thanks for like breaching the subject, because everybody's like scared to talk about it. So amongst your discussions about electric cars, let's talk about human population. Any other questions? All right, should we go do electric test drives? All right.
So a great thank you to Leilani. She's a wonderful person, humanitarian, activist, and the beautiful thing about Leilani is she's not afraid to go there on a limb. And that's what we have to do. We have to go out on a limb. We do it every day with our cars. We can also do it, as she suggested, with our diets and with the way we live and we interact with other human beings. So we can be the example, and the more we do this, the better. There is hope that we will continue to live as a species. I highly recommend Racing Extinction if you haven't seen it. It is a documentary that you can find on Amazon and Netflix. And it's about an hour and a half, and it really gets you to think about the planet we live on.